Lisa Messeri is an anthropologist of science who researches the human dimensions of scientific endeavors, focusing on planetary science and virtual reality. She's an assistant professor in the anthropology department at Yale University and was previously a lecturer at the University of Virginia. She studied aerospace engineering as an undergraduate at MIT before earning a PhD in anthropology and is author of the very recommended book, Placing Outer Space, an Earthly Ethnography of Other Worlds. Thank you, Lisa, for joining us today.
Thank you so much. Buenas tardes. Thank you so much for this invitation. I'm very excited to share some of my research with everyone here, as well as to be part of the conversation today and the subsequent workshops and conversations for the days that follow. So yes, as Margarita kindly introduced, I am an anthropologist of science, and what that means operationally is that I study the scientific meaning, the cultural meaning of scientific practice. I employ the centuries-old anthropological hanging out method, where I spend extended amount of time with scientists in their natural habitat, i.e. their laboratories or their field sites, and I try to understand what cultural meaning the inscriptions and words that these scientists produce have for people beyond science. In particular, what I focus on most is the idea of place and placemaking. And I mean this very colloquially. We all kind of understand what it means to be in a place like Madrid. We understand what our hometowns are and the meaning that they hold for us. And the question that I have is how ideas of place and placemaking have a role to play in scientific work, in a practice that we think of as somehow outside of place or beyond place. What role does something as subjective as place have in the objective practice of science? So what I'm going to talk about today, therefore, is how place matters for planetary scientists. So the talk, how planets become worlds and how worlds become futures, become is the operative word here. Become is what I'm using to think about as placemaking. Planets are not obviously places and worlds, but must be made so. And so how do scientists and collaborations with artists, therefore, produce worlds? How are places like planetary worlds made? And more so, what cultural meaning and value do they have in the term, in the idea of speculative futures, which is, of course, a topic very germane to today's, all the talks today. So I worked in general with two kinds of planetary scientists, Mars scientists and exoplanet astronomers, exoplanets being planets in orbit around stars other than our sun. And I'm going to talk about exoplanets for today, but happy to talk about Mars at any point, really, ever. So this was already alluded to. In 2017, in February, just this few months ago, a very exciting discovery was announced. This was the discovery of the TRAPPIST-1 system, a system of seven exoplanets orbiting a star 50 light years away. Can't hop there. Takes quite a journey to get there, but the light has in fact reached us, so we can detect this system. And this was a very exciting discovery. There was press conferences, you could read about it in the newspaper, and the reason was two reasons. One is that this was the first, one of the first solar systems other than the sun to have multiple planets, so more than just detecting one or two, but in this case seven. And the fact that all of these seven planets were close enough to the star that they were rocky and therefore possibly Earth-like made it even more exciting. So the scientists at NASA, who in conjunction with the European Space Organization made this discovery, kind of talked about the TRAPPIST-1 system as a laboratory of sorts. It would allow us to test ideas of what planets may or may not be able to house life and what may or may not be similar to worlds like our own. So looking at this image, you get a sense that we know something about these planets. There's a wonderful variety. Some look maybe like Mercury in their yellowness. Others are a bit more gaseous. Some seem to have a cloud pattern just like Earth. In reality, this is what the planets look like. You see the what are called series of light curves on the left side of the screen. That's the data that scientists work with. A very important point in all of this is that exoplanets are, for all intents and purposes, invisible. We can't see them. We're not pointing our telescopes at the planet and seeing them. Instead, the scientists very cleverly point their telescope at the sun and then observe slight variations of the star, whether it dims a little bit or moves and wobbles in a little way. And so what scientists actually detect are the traces, the potentiality of a planet. So the light curves, which is how the TRAPPIST-1 system represents a dip in the overall luminosity of the star. So you get a star shining, and then every once in a while, it's a little bit dimmer. And the thought is, ah, that's a shadow. And moreover, that's a shadow of a planet passing in front of the star. So again, we're not looking at the planet, we're looking at the star. The planets are so dim in comparison to the brightness of the star that they are invisible. And yet, what we see here in these two images is a translation from data into worlds. How does that happen? How does the left image become the image on the right? How do scientists transform planets from scientific data into worlds? So that overall question is the topic of my book, which I will plug right here, available on Amazon.com. This book is an anthropological examination of scientific practice, looking at several different kinds of techniques that that scientists use to transform planets from data into worlds. And my argument is that this is deeply about place and placemaking, and that this isn't something that scientists just put on at the end to display to the public, but in fact is part of the day-to-day work and conversation of scientists amongst themselves. That translating planets from data into places and into worlds is for the scientists themselves personally meaningful, and what allows them to kind of connect to the objects, the planets, that they study. So in the book itself, I talk about a variety of techniques by which placemaking occurs, habitability, map making, etc. For today's talk, I'm going to examine one particular kind of placemaking technique, summarized effectively as visualization, and so showing how visualizations aid scientists in producing place. And even though space is far out, kind of very much outside of our day-to-day realm, what I want to kind of zero in on, especially at the end, is to think about, well, what are the broader social and political implications that this kind of scientific practice and this kind of image making and production have for us? Fundamentally and essentially, Earth is a planet. We live on a planet, but we also conceptualize it in turn as a world, as a place. And if we can understand, yet place is often thought of as a local concept. If we can begin to understand how these scientific practitioners are able to scale place up to the scale of the planetary, and how therefore the planetary becomes meaningful on a human scale, might this be a way that we have a new language and a new form of interacting and understanding our own planet, Earth, as a planetary place and as a world, and especially as in the academic literature, we're increasingly referring to Earth as planetary in effort to get away from some of the sticky language around globalization. What if, in fact, planetary is perhaps a little bit too anesthetized, and this idea of thinking about Earth as a planetary world and place will engender caring in our own thinking and theorizing about Earth? So, that's the introduction. For the rest of the talk, I'm going to really focus on this idea of images in keeping with the theme of this symposium. So there's three kind of images that I'm going to talk about. This scientific image, which you've already been introduced to, and these light curves, and we're going to look at a little bit more in depth about how scientists think about the images and produce them. Second is the artistic image, these beautiful landscapes that, in collaboration with artists, scientists produce to give a sense of the surface of many of these planets. And finally, a particular kind of artistic image called a touristic, well, I'm calling it a touristic image, and a set of images produced by NASA JPL that kind of invite a human imagination of going to and being at these exoplanets. So the first two sections, the scientific and artistic set of images, is really focusing on how planets become worlds. This technique of placemaking employed here. And then when we turn over to the touristic images at the end, it's going to be about how worlds become futures, how captured in these images is a sense of not only an abstract future, but a human future implicated in these worlds. And yet, even as we talk about future and this very high-tech idea of planet hopping, I'm going to argue that ultimately a lot of this search, especially search for planets like our own Earth, is seeped in nostalgia, that there is a certain amount of nostalgia inherent in the work of exoplanet astronomy, and that has to do with this desire to find a planet, a world like our own, and this is especially, I think, rich and needed given the own precarity of climatological and political futures at this moment of historic time. So let's begin with the scientific image. So the first kind of image I'm going to talk about. The argument that I'd like to make here is that as you can kind of begin to see from the scientific graphs, there's very little data that these scientists are working with. Even as there is a desire to know intimately these planets and what exactly they are, there's a lot of imagination that has to go into this. And therefore, what the scientist comes away from is not a singular specificity of a possible planet, but rather a plurality, an ambiguity that's inherent in exoplanet astronomy. So we'll begin kind of leaning into that ambiguity. But first, just to give a bit of background, the first confirmed exoplanet detected around a star other than our sun was in 1995, not very long ago. That first, these first planets, the first 100, 200, 300 planets were all these gas giants, huge planets bigger than Jupiter, nothing that we could really understand as anything close to the planet that we live on. I began my field work, my work with these scientists in 2009, so you can see that at that time, less than 500 exoplanets were still known. And so every discovery was still quite exciting, and I was also working at the time when the first planets closer in size to Earth were starting to be discovered. So the most exciting thing that could have happened then was to discover a planet smaller. The smaller the planet, the better. We just kind of wanted them to get smaller and smaller. And so I was working at a time when super Earths were kind of the big thing, a planet just a little bit bigger than our own. Now, you can see that 2009 also you begin to get an upward of this curve, and that was with the launch of the Kepler space satellite that NASA launched in 2009, and that is what has led to this, a dedicated exoplanet detector has led to us now knowing over 3,000 exoplanets. And this is not 3,500 exoplanets in the whole universe, it's not that many in our galaxy. These are 3,500 exoplanets right in like the local neighborhood of our galaxy, just like a couple hundred light years around our own planet in our small little unimportant arm of the galaxy. There are literally infinite worlds. We are scratching the surface, and I think part of the enormity of exoplanet astronomy is why it so readily leads to this proliferation of imagination and speculation about the kind of worlds that might be there. When I began working with in exoplanet astronomy as an anthropologist, my main guide to the field is Sarah Seeger. She's an astronomer at MIT, and I spent a lot of time in the Green Building, which is that tall building there, hanging out with exoplanet astronomers. I went to their coffee hours, to the talks that they held. I worked with undergraduates as a researcher. Even though my coding was not very good, I was about as good as an undergrad. And in doing so, Sarah Seeger became my guide, inviting me to conferences and kind of showing me how she understood exoplanets, how she comes to see exoplanets, and importantly, and what I'm going to talk about, is how she trained her students to begin to see exoplanets as worlds. In the very beginning, how do you pull out from this data the idea that a world could exist in kind of these messy points that are being returned from the sky? So as you see, and so when Sarah Seeger is a full professor at MIT, and yet she's has quickly rocketed to the top of her field. She won a MacArthur Genius Award and was recently profiled in the New York Times and is seen here giving a TED Talk. And you can see behind her, and I've seen her give several public talks, and she always animates them with these kind of beautiful animations of lava worlds rich with gassy fumes, I guess. But in reality, working with her on the day-to-day, this is what an exoplanet looks like. These are the images that animate the day-to-day work of these scientists. And so what we have in the top row, you're hopefully becoming very familiar with seeing a light curve and understanding that little dip means, oh, it's a planet. Likewise, that more sinusoidal curve, that's the wobble of a star expecting a planet might be there. And you can kind of see on the top row what I'm trying to show is there's, in these scant data, there is somewhat of a singularity there, a single light curve, a single trace that the data follows. Now, if you're wanting to go beyond just there is or there isn't an exoplanet beyond this, around the star, that's when things get more complicated. And so the bottom set of images are really trying to show the ambiguity in this data. The large, colorful splotches that abstractly are quite beautiful are really trying to get at the idea of probability. What is the probability that the atmosphere might be like this or the surface might be like that? So you have this clean singularity on the top, this multiplicity on the bottom, and as you might imagine for a new scientist or someone training, thinking about the object that they're studying as is as ambiguous, as maybe not even there, is quite nerve-wracking. And so the ability to see with clarity planets in this data becomes an important part of the pedagogical experience of being trained as an exoplanet astronomer. In other words, trying to understand how worlds and concrete worlds are in this data becomes part of, in fact, shoring up the professional identity of the scientist herself. So in order to illustrate this with a bit more detail, I'm going to share one example of a discovery that occurred while I was working with Seeger and how she trained her graduate student in the art of seeing exoplanets. So transport back to December 2009 when a very exciting exoplanet was discovered, romantically called GJ1214b. All the exoplanets have these like choo-choo-choo-choo names, which you can explain. So here's two headlines that were announcing this. So in Wired, which is a technology popular magazine, the title is Most Earth-like Exoplanet, Exosolar Planet Found Right Next Door. And its lead is Meet GJ1214b, the most Earth-like planet ever found outside our solar system. Conversely, in the New York Times, a sultry world is found orbiting a distant star. Call it steam world. Astronomers said Wednesday that they have discovered a planet composed mostly of water. You would not want to live there. So what you see in these two headlines is already a bit of an ambiguity about what this kind of world is. Is it this familiar neighbor next door inviting you to the surface, or is it a sultry planet that is so alien and so distant that to even call it something like Earth is disingenuous? So again, at this moment in 2009, there were no Earth-like planets found, no TRAPPIST-1 systems floating around. This was big news because this was the first exoplanet found that was kind of close in size to our planet. And the question that I'm going to unpack right here in a vignette is, how did these kind of two news articles that are so contrasting in the kind of world this planet is imagined, how did those come to be what became popularly circulated beyond the scientific circles? So the discovery also in 2009 was announced in Nature, and it was more subtly in the scientific article, a super Earth transiting a nearby low mass star. And again, you see the light curve as evidence that this planet exists. And the lead scientist was David Charbonneau, who was a professor at Harvard and colleagues with Sarah Seeger, who I was working with at MIT. And he knew that this was going to be a headline-making discovery. And the question that he had was, can we say what kind of world this is? Do we know anything about this beyond the fact that it exists and roughly its size? And Seeger has been working her whole career on trying to model exoplanets, and so he brought her in early in the discovery to see if she could offer some clarity to what was sure to be a big discovery. So in September, so fast forward a few months before those news articles, in September of that year, in 2009, Charbonneau offered his data set to Seeger and her student Jessica and gave them the challenge of attempting to characterize this world. Can we say whether it's a water world or a steam world or an ocean planet? To what extent does this data contain anything beyond simply the fact that the planet exists? When I arrived to a meeting in September 2009, Seeger very excitedly explained this project to me and her graduate student Jessica and said, "What we're doing is we're trying to interpret a new planet." Now, what she meant by it being new is that most of the planets discovered to date, this is a figure that appeared in the scientific article announcing GJ-1214b's discovery, is that most are these like populated up in that left right corner are the gas giants, these really huge planets elsewhere. And each of these lines represent kind of the planets in our solar system. And GJ-1214b, the object of interest, is kind of right between Earth and Neptune. So the question she was asking is, okay, well, is this a planet that's a super Earth, just a bit bigger than Earth, or is it a mini Neptune, kind of like an icy world, or is it something completely different? Is it something beyond what we have been able to imagine, imagine to date? So given that they were able to know the mass, radius, and density, that's kind of what you get from these light curves, to what extent could you go beyond this? In September of 2009, everything started very optimistically. This was going to be Jessica, the graduate student's first big project, and she was excited about such a big deal planet being what she got to work with. However, slowly the sparsity, the bareness of the data set in, and Jessica would arrive frustrated and dejected to each of the subsequent meetings. The programs that she was writing to model the planets simply weren't converging, so she was left with hundreds of different possibilities of what this planet means. They had thought in the beginning that surely we were at the stage where all the data would converge on one or two planetary possibilities, but in reality, a plurality of planets emerged, that not a single world came out of the data, but rather a multiplicity of worlds. And again, as a new scientist, this was very disheartening for Jessica, who felt that her career was going to depend on whether she could or couldn't characterize this planet. In the end, what Seeger and Jessica decided to do in writing about the composition of GJ-1214b was to offer a statement to the scientific community that, in fact, they couldn't say what GJ-1214b was. Instead, perhaps they could outline the possibilities. What are the probabilities of the kind of planet it might be? So in their final paper, what they ended up doing effectively was taking the singularity proposed by the light curves in Charbonneau's discovery paper and translating them into a different set of images that tried to capture the ambiguity and the multiplicity of the planetary world. So again, from the images on that side, all you really need to understand is the beautiful colors are probabilities, and it's probabilities of different combinations of gas, rock, and ice that might compose this planet. So the images on the left, again, show a kind of specificity, singularity, and the ones on the right show this multiplicity and ambiguity. It shows that while there is a desire for world making, it can't quite come into being in these particular scientific images. So in the paper, Seeger and Jessica write that we cannot constrain GJ-1214b's composition. We can constrain GJ-1214b's composition, but we cannot infer its unique true composition. So a bit of frustration there, whereas we know something about this planet, but we don't know everything about this planet. In other words, the worldliness of it has yet to fully come to be. So if you recall the ambiguity of those news articles from Wired and from New York Times, you can begin to see why you have either a sultry world or a welcoming world. And it's because depending on the scientists spoken with, they might have a different mental image of what GJ-1214b is and express that differently to the journalists they were talking to. So these scientific images are a step, a beginning into the process of placemaking, but they don't always create that kind of singular world that perhaps we would desire to know these exoplanets as. So that brings us to the second kind of image, the artistic image. So this is a shift from the pragmatic scientific images into the more imaginative realm of artistic interpretation. It's a way to take the ambiguity of the scientific images and reassert a more singular sense of what the exoplanet is as a world and as a place. Furthermore, it then brings that singular understanding to a broader audience. It kind of begins to translate what perhaps is harder to understand because of its multiplicity into something that can circulate more easily across a broader audience. So recall again that exoplanets are invisible, that we're not looking at the planet itself, but simply the star, and we get data from the star that help us believe a planet might be there. What the artist can then do is help to make the invisible visible. I'm going to talk about one particular astronomical artist, Lynette Cook. I met Cook when I was living in San Francisco doing my the research for this project, and I visited her at her house to kind of see how she works as an exoplanet artist. Because she was living in the Bay Area, which is where some of the first exoplanets were discovered in the mid to late 90s, she was one of the first artists, scientific illustrators, that was brought on board to collaborate with artists, with scientists and astronomers as the discoveries were made. So this is her artistic depiction of 51 Pegasi b, another very beautiful name for an exoplanet. And this was the first exoplanet ever discovered. So this was around a sun-like star. So her depiction here shows a star not dissimilar to one that might look quite familiar. And the planet, 51 Pegasi b, was about the size of Jupiter, but zipping around the sun so fast that it was closer than Mercury, orbiting its sun once every 4 days. So you have this super Jupiter, they called it, kind of zipping around the sun. And she was brought in to kind of create an imagination of this world. What might it look like? So she kind of drew a bit of a Jupiter-looking planet and trying to show more than anything the proximity to the sun, which was kind of the most notable thing about this very first discovery. Now, in these early days, in the mid to late 90s, there were basic details known about planets. You know the size and the color of the star, you roughly know the size of the planet, and you kind of know the distance that the planet is from the sun, and not much else. And especially in these early days, when the field was so new, when planets were so few known, the scientists, in working with the artists, required a certain amount of conservatism from them. They really didn't want the artist to speculate too much. They didn't want to overpromise anything about the world to the wider audience that might be viewing it. So Cook, in talking about her collaborations with scientists, often talked about it as an iterative process, that she would kind of create this kind of fabulous world, and they would come back and have her tone it down, and it would kind of go back and forth in a negotiation between scientific realism and artistic desire and speculation. In these early days, the one place that the scientists would allow Cook to take her artistic license was on the issue of moons. So whereas they were not particularly welcome to let Cook speculate on what surfaces of exoplanets might be, because the data is nowhere near specific enough to say if a moon does or doesn't exist, they let her go wild. They're like, oh, I don't know, there might be a moon. Feel free to draw one and make it however you want, because it doesn't exist. So therefore, you can do anything. And so she began to draw the exoplanets that were discovered. So here, the main discovery is Ursa Majoris C, which is the Saturn-looking planet. But she's choosing to draw the planet from the position of the moon. And what the moon allows is a bit more information. You get the sense of temperature, that there's molten lava on the surface. So it must be quite warm, quite close to the sun. Likewise, if there was ice caps, it would show you that you're much further out in the solar system. As Cook said to me, it tells the viewer what could be there. What the moon further allowed was the inclusion of landscape, elements of landscape, into these exoplanet images. Many exoplanet astronomers and exoplanet artists, rather, are quite relate the work and the choosing of their perspective to the Hudson River School, the late 19th century American school of painting, first starting in the Hudson River Valley on the East Coast, then moving towards the West, and having this idea of bringing the traveler who could not journey quite that far to that place, to a place where they couldn't go. As Lynette says, the space artist, and one could say this about early landscape artists as well, are showing worlds that the rest of society cannot see, that we cannot travel to. It makes the distant worlds in our universe seem more real and close and more a part of our lives. So there's this very explicit placemaking that Cook, as an artist in collaboration with the scientist she was working with, is striving for, and one that's dating back to a painterly aesthetic rooted in the 19th century. Now, whereas Cook was very constrained by the conservatism of the early days with exoplanet scientists, where they simply did not want speculation too far beyond the data itself, today's exoplanet art has faded away. Now, if you're reading an article on online about an exoplanet discovery, you're likely greeted with a beautiful image like this one here. Invisible worlds have melted away, and these colorful worlds have come into being in their place. And these are gorgeous to look at, but they come with a couple problems. First, what happens is that in seeing an image like this and being told that this is TRAPPIST-1F, you lose the ambiguity that remains inherent in the images. You lose the ambiguity that scientists have to deal with when thinking about the limits of their scientific work and their discoveries. Secondarily, if you're just skimming through and clicking through articles in your normal daily news digest, you might not realize that we haven't seen these worlds. These are becoming, so photorealism is the trend in exoplanet art, and you might think that we've been there, that maybe we have a high zoom on our telescope and we're able to just kind of slip over to the surface. And so what you lose is the fact that this, the light curve, is still what is known, that there's a tremendous amount of work that has to go into transforming the little dip, the little shadow of a star, into the landscape that are produced alongside the announcement of these discoveries. So with all this as a bit of a background, we can now turn to the third image, the third kind of image, which I'm calling the touristic image, which is part of the a subset of the artistic images. So if you'll believe me that scientists see worlds in data, as we explored in the top corner, and that artists translate these imaginations into landscapes, then we have to begin to ask that if exoplanets are worlds and places, might they also be destinations? In other words, are these human futures? Are there futures, and are these futures that speak to both beyond Earth, but also to Earth itself? To answer these questions of how worlds become futures, I want to talk about one particular set of images called Visions of the Future. This is a set of a dozen or so images produced by NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California. And they are described on the website where you can go and you can download these and print them out in beautiful full scale and hang them on your wall as imaginative travel destinations. That's what the website uses to describe this series. The first ones were released in February 2016. They immediately filled my Twitter and my Facebook timelines with everyone posting how cool they were. And what they represent are collaborations between artists, illustrators, scientists, and engineers based out of NASA JPL, which heads up one of the big exoplanet discovery projects. Now, just like the exoplanet artistic landscapes, which are calling back to the Hudson River School, these posters also resonate with an older visual aesthetic. In this case, the head of JPL is very clear in saying that he had recently come across some travel posters from the 1930s and 1940s that were produced by the Works Progress Administration in the United States in order to both put artists back to work during the Depression, as well as to encourage the emerging car culture of the United States to, quote, see America, to hop in their Fords and, you know, take a cheaper vacation with their family. So the director of NASA JPL, and these were all, a few years ago, were all reissued in the US, and you could like buy them in all the souvenir shops at the national parks, because we have souvenir shops at our national parks. And the translation. And so the NASA JPL was taking a vacation at the Grand Canyon, saw these posters, and said, that's it. That is the aesthetic that I want us to use in projecting the excitement of these exoplanets. So we took that as aesthetic inspiration back to his collective at JPL. And you can see very clearly the resonances. You can see that there's kind of the scale of natural beauty in both of them, as well as, in this case, there's both two of the human explorers. So placing the human within the realm of the natural in order to kind of present this sense of this is not only of the natural world, but this is of the human world as well. Some Google image searching also revealed that there were very similar aesthetic in travel posters globally. So this is put out by the Spanish Tourism Department in 1948. And not only is there this similar aesthetic, kind of the sole traveler amidst being framed by kind of the wonder that there is to see, but there is, of course, fantasy very much in both of these. In fact, in all of these images, you get a sense of fantasy of either futures or pasts or presents that are escaping the realities of what is actually going on in post-Civil War Spain, in 1930s and 40s US. These posters, specifically because they are about tourism, is about escape. And that leaches into the exoplanet posters as well. So the visions of the future series is, of course, is deeply steeped in the past, both aesthetically in appealing to the travel posters, but also symbolically. If you look again at these images, you have the white picket fence over for Kepler 186F. You have this kind of lone pioneer cowboy in the frontier in the middle, and you also have this kind of imagination of family, of a nuclear family traveling, peering out the window in the car as you're driving by, all the way over to the right. So you have this symbolic sense of the past as well as the aesthetic sense of the past. So these futures are saturated with nostalgia, but nostalgia for what? What are we longing for when we are presented with these images? Of the thousands of exoplanets that we know to exist, these are called out to get travel pictures of their travel posters of their own, and to be created and to become destinations, because each of these represents one step closer to us finally finding an Earth-like planet. So there's, in fact, steeped within these a nostalgia for our own planet, a nostalgia for discovering a pristine planet like our own, a planet that we have never known, but know that has to have once or hope to have once existed. This is a planet, exoplanet, untouched by pollution, unworried by politics. It's a nostalgia for an Earth as we have never known it, or maybe even the Earth that we remember from childhood when we were peering out the windows and seeing the beauty of nature without really understanding the nature culture that is subscribed all around it before we had all read Haraway. So within this image, within these visions of the futures, there's one more that I'd like to show you. And this is the travel poster for Earth, your oasis in space. So these exoplanet tourists do eventually come home. They stop back for recharging. This is the only poster where the helmet, the space helmet, is off. And the slogan is, the air is free and the breathing is easy. But of course, you look at this, and there is nostalgia here for an Edenic Earth, right? You kind of see the apple tree, which I think even alludes to kind of the Garden of Eden quality that we hope in hundreds of years when we are planet hopping, our own planet will be recognizable as something that continues to have this these pristine views and landscapes in front of us. So there's also a hope that our own planet's future is going to be recognizable, something that we can, in fact, return to. So that is the journey we have taken from planets becoming worlds to worlds becoming futures. And these images are kind of a guide for us to understand the practice of placemaking, the scientific practice of placemaking aided by the artistic imagination. From scant data, worlds are imagined. And further, these worlds invite speculating about human futures and what that might look like amongst the stars. These futures are aesthetically and substantively linked to the past. And deeply, these placemaking practices are just fundamentally part of scientific practice. And so if we're going to understand how past, present, and future imaginations are being cultivated, we really have to understand how they are informed and informed by exoplanetary astronomical practice. And though I didn't dwell on this, what I hope that we open up to in questions and in the discussion are the social and political structures that these images imply that we're going to carry beyond Earth. Given that exoplanets are invisible, are not worlds and not planet places, and that we're actively making them as such, we need to be aware of what structures, what social and cultural structures we are bringing into these imaginations, what we therefore naturalize, and then what we assume exoplanets must be and must be like. So I think that we can take inspiration from the scientists who struggle with the multiplicity of planets. But the saving grace of such multiplicity is that it's also a multiplicity of futures. And if we lean into that multiplicity, the hope is that we can open up a variety of imaginations about what human and non-human futures might be, both in the cosmos, but of course, on here, down here on Earth as well. So, thank you.
Thank you, Lisa, for the presentation. It was great to journey through these images. And I'll just introduce a question and take a few and just open the Q&A straight to the audience, because I know you came from far away to listen. And I couldn't help but wonder through Interstellar, of course. Sorry, a bit of mainstream pop here. While I look at these images, because there is this moment when they have very few gas and they have to decide what planet to visit. And they are speculating, how's the atmosphere here? How's the gravity? How do we survive? How do we manage our resources? So this thing of the world as promise that you know, becomes very stressed on this moment of inference of data. So I guess my question is, delving a bit more into your last statements, is on the first images when we don't have humans on the picture of the exoplanets data, but actually we have like the after image of humans. We have the ghostly presence of this human that uses kind of this stereoscopic view, you know? So inferring like a 3D potential from these data landscapes. And it actually, they tell us a lot about the technological tools, how they're interpreted, and what kind of communities and also institutions are making these tools. So we're going maybe a bit further into the Silicon Valley ideology and how programming, funding of programming and of new software is informing how these images are generated. I think it's very important.
Yeah, so absolutely. So the scientific image presented here, what I'm showing is a cleaned image. Most of the time that I spent maybe 6 months working with Sarah Seeger and her group, during that time, almost everything we learned was how to clean an image. How do you actually get what comes in from the telescope and gets processed as this? So this is not what comes down from the telescope. Instead, you get this whole messy thing. And in order to, in fact, find this singular image requires a lot of networks to be in place. So a lot of the images that we were working with when I was with Seeger was from the Corot Space Telescope, which was launched by the France Space Space Institute, and we could not understand at all what this data meant. There was all these ghosts, in fact, and artifacts that we couldn't process and figured out what they were. And so it wasn't until postdocs from the EU came and visited us and actually told us, like gave us the raw data and told us what everything was and decoded it for us, that we were ourselves able to work with it. So exoplanet astronomy depends on an international network of scientists. It depends also, and I think this is part of what you're getting at, an increase in funding of big data, because especially now with 3,500 exoplanets, and Kepler has returned terabytes upon terabytes of information, how do you sort through that? So that's requiring the development of new data processes, which is requiring the employment of computer scientists who weren't necessarily trained in astronomy but could come up with the algorithms to process this. It's also requiring, and I think this is very interesting, a whole army of citizen scientists. So if you go to like Exoplanet Zoo or something, I forget what it is right now, but you as just like your own person on the computer can kind of click through all this data and say, you are asked, is there something interesting or not here? And you sitting on your computer kind of click, 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 and are helping Kepler make the first, and the NASA scientists make the first steps towards going through. So you get this sense of outsourcing as well that's happening. So, I mean, there's so many currents about how we conceptualize data that you really have to understand to know even how this simple image gets produced.
Maybe we pass around the microphone and ask for some questions from the room. Any curious people? Joel, yeah. Is there a microphone because of the recording? Wait. And the interpreters.
It's not a question. I don't like have a specific question right now. It's going to come. But I just wanted to say that I think I was very impressed by the presentation, and I think it kind of gave so much very pertinent observation about things that are not so obvious, I think. And I'm pretty impressed by the quality and the deepness of your work. That's what's just like. And otherwise, I was always, because regarding like this kind of, you mentioned it at the end, but like this idea of escapism, like in the way this kind of kind of dream cell, like through these visuals and all this kind of representation, how come like it is a way like to kind of avoid political institution to focus on proper human problems, you know, and things that just arrived like next to even like the studios or like the headquarters of these companies. And so, you know, if I don't know, I don't think that it's a political program, but like there's something that is definitely, you know, a way to escape to a certain kind of reality. And that might be one question.
Yeah, no, so science pretends to be apolitical. It has strategically managed to plant itself outside of the political, in a way that it means when you look at these things from the first blush, you think, oh, well, this is just NASA sharing its data with the world. What can be the harm of that? What can be the politics of that? And I could be very pessimistic, you know, and read all of the politics into these images. In my work, I tend not to be, because part of what I do as an anthropologist is try to understand the scientist's work in the scientist's own eyes. That said, I think you can't avoid it. I think it's disingenuous to say that these truly are apart from politics and apart from culture. Therefore, so the way that I began to bring the politics back in, which I, again, only kind of allude to in this talk, is to ask the question of why now? So why is it that this science explosion is happening now? You can't just answer it by saying, oh, we now have the tools to do it, therefore that's why it's happening now. That kind of technological determinism, I don't think, gets you to the correct answer of this. But also, why these touristic posters now? Why in 2016 did this, why was it this particular imagination of exoplanets in this particular year? And then I think the only way to answer that question is through politics and through understanding kind of the social and political means by which these were produced. And yes, that then forces you to think about, okay, well, what's NASA JPL? What is their situatedness in Los Angeles, in California? What is, kind of in the waning years of the Obama administration, I think you have this optimism that perhaps 4 years from now, is being slowly obliterated and abolished in, I think, even the scientific imagination in the United States. So can these images proliferate when there is less optimism in kind of national and less national optimism, which supports it? Will there even be funding, for example, to fund the sciences, to fund the arts, and to fund that very weird intersection, as we were talking about, of science and art? So to summarize, or to kind of put a head in it, I was never very good at asking what the politics of the scientists I worked with were, because they don't like those conversations. But I found a lot more access to thinking about the politics through looking at the inscriptions that they leave behind and where they come from. And these are all just very preliminary thoughts. I think there's a lot more speculation that we could all make on the conditions of these the production of these images.
Thank you.
Julie.
Thank you, Lisa. That was fantastic. You talked about expertise. I just wondered if you could say a little bit more about the construction of expertise and knowledge. You talked about that in terms of the scientific expertise. Mm-hmm. And I wondered if you'd asked the scientists what they thought of the artistic interpretations. And if there's time, a second question, which was what struck me was that these are speculative images that may well be being accepted by the scientists. And that struck me that other kind of speculative data, like climate modeling, is often questioned as not being real or true. So I'm wondering what the differences are between the two kinds of different visualizations around speculative data.
Oh, that's great. And we can answer that. I think we can answer that second question together. I think we'll need both of our expertise there. So for expertise, the first one, so the way that I approached how an exoplanet astronomer becomes an exoplanet astronomer after where I ended on the other side was how they learned to see. So how Seeger trained her undergraduates and her graduate students how to see. And what my interpretation was that the first step of learning how to see was learning how to see the messy data and how to see the telescope in it, how to see the planets in it, how to see the star in it, how to see cosmic rays in it. And then once you got that, that's like kind of the undergraduate way of seeing. Then you have this more sophisticated way of seeing, which is what she and Jessica were working on. So once you've kind of clarified it, can you complicate it again? So all of her students were working on these incredibly messy visualizations, trying to understand probabilities in a way that not all the groups were. This was really specific to Seeger's research group. And so I really saw learning how to see as a mode of expertise. And so when we were talking in a larger group of scientists, if we were like they had a journal club. So every week we would read a journal article together on a recent exoplanet discovery. And the first way that these scientists would read journals was not to like read the abstract and the sentences, but to look at the figures. So we would always look at the pictures first. We would look at figure one, figure two, work all the way through. And the question that would be asked was, do you believe it? Do you believe the visualization being presented? Like, do you believe that there is a planet in this? Because sometimes the error bars were so big that they'd be able to say, I don't believe it. So learning how to see data as planets and whether a planet actually exists in that data, to me, was what became expert and how expertise was formed. So when I would work with and interview astronomers, I would ask them if they collaborated with artists and what that process would like. So I kind of was attempting to get it from both sides. And especially because I was, a lot of the astronomers that I spoke with were kind of involved in the early days of exoplanet astronomy, where basically everyone found a planet and everyone had an artist, which was possible when there was only 50 exoplanets known. They kind of all reported these very genial relationships with artists. And they always said, like, the artist pushed too hard, I had to rein them back in, but then they loved it. They all have these artistic images on their offices, right? That's like kind of what is very much motivational. But the question that I would then always ask the astronomer is, what does an exoplanet look like to you? And they wouldn't point to the art. They would instead draw a light curve. So even though kind of that art served as inspiration, it served as a way to get a student or a colleague interested in what they're doing, the way they saw exoplanets was as data, which I just always thought was really interesting. So they kind of didn't, you know, they thought the artistic work was obviously very important, but they didn't see it as science. Yeah, and I think that's a great question about climate data versus, and they're both speculative. My first order answer would say, kind of also going to the previous question, which is the political stakes here are nil. And so it's great to believe that this landscape exists. There's no ramifications, perhaps. Not with climate data. They're too real.
Maybe we cut to the next speaker, and Julie will introduce Kleiner and a couple of us. Thank you so much, Lisa.
Thank you, guys.